Thank you. gives Maddie to be Philip's bride?
Her mother and I.
All right, Philip, go get your bride. You guys may now be seated. And let's pray together. Jesus, thank you so much for this amazing, special day that Philip and Maddie are choosing to dedicate their lives together, that this day the two of them are no longer two individuals but one unit. And I pray, God, that their marriage from this day forward would just be a reflection of the gospel, that you, Christ, would be just at the center of their relationship, and that you would bless them. Thank you for every individual here today, God, coming to support what you're doing here, what you're joining together. And we just say with you, God, yes to what's happening, and we want to be here to agree and support Philip and Maddie in this moment. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, hey, on behalf of Philip and Maddie, thank you, everyone, for being here on this special celebratory day. We're glad there was enough chairs. There was a little frightening happening in the house that there wouldn't be, but glad you all were able to be here this afternoon. Well, not sure if you guys have heard much of the story of Philip and Maddie and the history of their relationship. I have had the privilege of getting to do their premarital counseling and have known Maddie since she was a youngster, and have known Philip for the past couple of years, and getting to hear their story was pretty incredible, and I figured I would share a little part of it with you guys today. So Maddie and Philip both come to the story, and Maddie was over time starting to notice this single handsome gentleman by the name of Philip, and she regularly was kind of scoping him out a little bit, you know, taking note, like, who is this dude? But it seemed like Philip wasn't ever really noticing Maddie, and she was like, man, you know, what's going on? Like, what's the deal here? And one day, luckily, Maddie overheard Philip talking about Stranger Things, and Maddie was like, well, maybe if I talk about Stranger Things loud enough, he'll hear that I like it, and then it'll kind of work out. So in church, Maddie kind of starts, you know, talking about Billy and Eleven and Demogorgons and stuff like that, and she's talking about it really loud so that hopefully Philip will hear, but it just doesn't work. Philip still, like, pays no attention to her, and so wasn't really working out. And luckily they got some close family friends that they're both really close with, the Yoncer family. And the Yoncers did Maddie a favor and said, you know what, we're gonna set it up so that you guys can sit together at church. So Danny's gonna sit by Maddie, and Philip can come and sit by Kevin and Travis, and then maybe it'll work out. And so Maddie was pretty stoked on it, like, oh my gosh, we're gonna get to sit together at church. And they sat by each other, and kind of same thing happened. There was really, you know, no magical sparks in the air. Philip said, you know, growing up with Danny as a close family friend, he was like, I just thought Maddie was gonna be just like Danny, just like this kind of annoying little girl or whatever, you know. And so it didn't really work out with the setup. Well, eventually, Philip realized, you know, that this girl Maddie actually has some potential here, and she does seem pretty legit. And so he decided to take her rock climbing, but he needed a wingman. So, you know, he got his crew with him. He didn't want to do the one-on-one thing first, needed that accountability and whatnot. So took her rock climbing, and after that, it seemed to just really spark. He was like, man, you know, I've been really missing out on this Maddie girl. And so eventually he was like, you know what, it's time to take her out. It's time to do the one-on-one thing. So after church on a Sunday, Philip asks Maddie to go out to coffee together. And they made the foolish decision to go to Case Coffee downtown right by the church. And it's a foolish decision because that's where everybody goes after church. So they're in there on their hashtag first date and trying to get some quality one-on-one time, trying to get to know each other. And in walks the whole entire family, pretty much. Katie comes walking in, Bob Faulkner comes walking in, Jake and Jade come walking in. Everyone comes walking into their first date, and they're trying to just build a quality relationship, but it's not really working. So Philip does what any guy would do in that moment. He goes, it's time to get out of here and let's go shoot some guns, right? So he takes her shooting, they go shoot some guns, have a great time, you know, blasting things and stuff like that. It seems to be going pretty good. And then he realized that they're starving because They skipped lunch because Maddie was a little bit too embarrassed to eat in front of Philip. But he's like, hey, you know, if this thing's ever going to work out, we're going to have to eat together. So she decided to go to dinner with them, and they had a great romantic dinner. And just a few months later, here we are today, celebrating the two of them coming together and getting married. And so yes, give it up for Philip and Maddie. An amazing story of how God brought them together. But today, as the two of these individuals are choosing to give their lives to one another in marriage, I wanted to take a little bit of time and look at what marriage really is from the scriptures. And I've had the privilege of getting to share this stuff with Philip and Maddie, but wanted to just share it with you guys as well. So the question is, you know, where does marriage come from? And what really is the purpose of it? And this is a really important question in our culture today, because it seems like marriage is starting to become whatever people want it to be. But marriage actually has roots in the beginning of time. We see in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, God created everything. It says he created the heavens and the earth. And for 6 days, as God is creating all this amazing stuff, at the end of every single day in creation, God declared that what he created was good. It says he created the land and the sea, and it was good. He created the animals, and it was good. He created the sun and the moon, and it was good. He created day and night. Everything he created for 6 days, it was good, over and over and over again. But then we see something in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. When God created man, it says this. He declared, "It is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him." So something interesting happens here when God over and over again is declaring everything he made to be good. We see that as he looks at man sitting in the Garden of Eden by himself, he declares that that is not good. He says it's not good that man be alone. Now the question is, how could anything be not good when God had created a perfect creation, and at this point in time, there was no sin in the world? Sin had not entered, and yet God declared something is not good. And the reason man being alone in the Garden of Eden was not good is because when God created human beings, he did something unique with humans that he didn't do with any other part of creation. And we see in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, when God is creating human beings, he declared, "Let us make man in our own image, and after our likeness." Now, when God declares that, "Let us make man," us refers to the biblical truth that God is triune, that God has existed for eternity past in a relationship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So God is not a single person God who has lived out eternity past selfishly. He is a giving God. He is a relational God who has dwelt in eternity past in a relationship, which is why when man was chilling there in the Garden of Eden by himself, God said, "Man, this isn't good," because God created humans to reflect him. He made them in his image, and man could not do that if he was by himself for eternity. And so God created human beings to have relationships. We do this two ways. Number one, God created us to have relationship with him vertically. And I'm so pleased to be able to stand here before all these witnesses and to let you guys know that both Philip and Maddie have found their vertical relationship with Jesus. They've found the most important relationship in their life. What you guys are doing here today isn't the most important relationship. It's your relationship with Jesus. Being made in God's image means he created us to have relationship with him. And I've had the privilege of getting to see Philip and Maddie both continue to grow closer to Jesus as individuals. And I know that because of that, you guys are going to be able to keep him at the center of your marriage, which I'm just so excited about. But God not only created us to have vertical relationship with him, we were also created to have horizontal relationships with other human beings, which is why, again, man being in the Garden of Eden by himself was not a good thing, because to reflect a relational being, we needed another relational being on the earth. And so God created marriage from the beginning of time to be, as we see here in Genesis 1, between one man and one woman who become one flesh for one lifetime for the purpose of bringing glory to the one true God. Now, here's the amazing thing. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, we see God eventually brings man a wife. It says he put him to sleep, and out of his side, he pulled a rib and he made a woman from his side. And Adam is there in the Garden of Eden. He wakes up from his
asleep, and he sees for the very first time a woman, another human being. Now, Adam, just before this, had the privilege of getting to name all the animals. He was like, man, here's Mr. and Mrs. Ape, Mr. and Mrs. Peacock, Mr. and Mrs. Penguin, Mr. and Mrs. Elephant. And he's like, this is messed up. There's no one for me, right? This is like, it's not fair. And then he wakes up and he sees a woman. He sees someone who is like him, and he declares, this at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. And then the scripture declares this, the principle from before the foundations of the world. He says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother, hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And what's happening today, the two of you choosing to become one, is God's design for fulfilling our need for horizontal relationships. He says the two of you are gonna choose and make a commitment to, from this moment forward, live your life together as a reflection of me. And that's the beautiful thing, is that marriage and two people becoming one flesh, it's so much more than just about you guys. It's so much more than just a picture of we love each other and we're in love and we want to live together. It's so much more. In fact, when Paul the Apostle in Ephesians chapter 5 talks about the two becoming one flesh, he says this mystery is profound, and yet I'm saying it refers to Christ and the church. So marriage, two people coming together to become one, is a reflection to the world of the commitment that Christ has made to us. How he has said, you no longer are your own, but you're mine. And how he has declared, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And so the purpose of marriage, what you guys are doing here today, is to reflect Jesus's sacrificial, unconditional love that he has shown to his bride, the church. And this is an amazing way that through your guys's relationship, the world can see Jesus, that you can bring Christ glory through your relationship. Our relationship with Christ isn't perfect by any means. He has said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Man, there's times when we leave, there's times when we forsake him, there's times when we sin, there's times when we fall short, and yet he's made a commitment to us. And in your guys' marriage, there's going to be times where you fall short. There's going to be times where you fail. There's going to be times where you struggle. There's going to be times where it's hard and you want to throw in the towel. And yet if you remember that the purpose of your marriage is to show the world Christ's unconditional love for us, and you choose, Philip, to unconditionally love Maddie, and you choose, Maddie, to unconditionally love Philip in the midst of all the trials and difficulties that inevitably will come, as they do to every relationship, the world sees something greater. They see something so much more than just two people in love. It's a picture and a reflection of the commitment that Christ has made to us, and that he chooses to make every single day to love us unconditionally, and he showed that love on the cross. And so I want to just encourage you guys from this day forward, man, remember back to this day where you said, we made that commitment not just for ourselves, but man, that our marriage would be a picture of how much Christ loves us, so much that he gave his life for us, and day by day, that you guys would lay down your lives to serve one another, so that the world can see Christ and the gospel in your marriage. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, hey, let's pray. Jesus, thank you again so much for this special day that Philip and Maddie are choosing to come together and to say, I'm willing to lay down my life, and I'm willing to die to myself, and I'm willing to choose unconditional love in spite of failure, in spite of sin, in spite of trials. I want my relationship with Philip, I want my relationship with Maddie to be more than that. I want it to be a reflection of the gospel. And so Jesus, use this couple today as the two are saying, we no longer are two, but we're one. God, would it be a reflection to the world of the oneness that we have in you, the relationship that you made possible through laying down your life. We just give you thanks, God, and we just pray a blessing over Philip and Maddie on this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, in light of that, there's an important question I gotta ask you guys, and I guess we'll start with Philip. So, Philip, do you take Maddie to be your wedded wife, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for richer or poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and cherish, till death do you part?
I do.
It's a good choice. I'm glad you said that. It's been really weird. And Maddie, Do you take Philip to be your wedded husband, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or worse, richer or poorer, sickness and in health, to love and cherish till death do you part?
I do.
Hey, good choice right there too. Thank you guys so much. Hey, well, in light of this commitment that you guys have made to each other, do you guys have some rings to exchange as a symbol and token of your commitment? All right. Well, let's start with Maddie this time. And Maddie, as you slip that onto his finger, just repeat after me. With this ring, I take you, Philip.
With this ring, I take you, Philip.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To love and cherish.
To love and to cherish.
As Christ loved the church.
As Christ loved the church.
And gave himself for it.
And gave himself for it.
Well, does anyone have any lotion? We'll get it. Baby. We'll get there. You got this, a little twist there.
This is really hard.
There it is. There it is.
It literally.
Hey, give it up. She made it happen. It's official. See, not everything's easy in marriage. Takes a little work, like I've been telling you guys.
Okay, I got it.
I knew you would. See, commitment, perseverance. There it is. And Philip, would you repeat after me as you place the ring on Maddie's finger? With this ring, I take you, Maddie.
With this ring, I take you, Maddie.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To love and cherish.
To love and cherish.
As Christ loved the church.
As Christ loved the church.
And gave himself for it.
And gave himself for it.
Awesome.
Lucky.
See, some things go smooth in marriage, too. That's great. Well, hey, Philip and Maddie have chosen as their first act as a married couple that they want to take communion together. And what communion is at the Last Supper, Jesus instituted it, and he said, as often as you do this, as often as you drink of the cup and eat of the bread, do it in remembrance of me. And since marriage is a picture of Christ's relationship with us, Maddie and Philip have chosen that they want to go to the communion table to remember what Christ has done for them and that he would be kept at the center of their marriage. And so as they take this personal moment to go and do that, I just want to encourage you guys, if you want to just say a prayer in your heart and say a blessing over them as they do this, that would be welcomed at this time as well. You guys can head to the communion table. All right, you guys, we've made it. Should I preach a few more hours or?
I'm good.
Well, hey, by the power invested in me by the state of Oregon, but more importantly, by our Lord Jesus Christ, I now pronounce you man and wife. And Philip, you can now kiss your bride. Well, hey, it's my privilege for the very first time. I'd like to announce to you guys Mr. and Mrs. Philip and Maddie Toda.
Hey, thank you all for coming. And to those of you that helped out on this, I can't tell you how much we appreciate all your help. And anybody else that stays and helps break down will get a big thank you. Sorry, standing in front of the bride. Can't do that. Maddie won't talk to me after this. Anyway, thank you, and God bless you guys. Drive home safely.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, cheers.
All right, so Travis, do you mind starting us off?
So Webster's Dictionary defines wedding as the fusing of two metals with a hot torch. We have two medals here, gold medals. That's a little quote from The Office because I've always wanted to do that in a wedding speech. So Philip and I met when we grew up in Phoenix together, so backtrack to the 90s. We lived in the middle of downtown Phoenix, like two blocks from the elementary school, and Philip's house was like a football throw from my basketball hoop. And so Kevin, my older brother, his best friend lived down around the corner, and when I was like seven, my mom would let me like skip down to go find my older brother at his friend's house. And so I'm going down to find Kevin at Al's house, and I see this younger kid, probably in his underwear, in the ditch in somebody's front yard with a bunch of Tonka trucks and Hot Wheels in the mud. And I was like, I like Tonka trucks and I like mud. And so we became friends because that's how things work when you're seven. And so my oldest brother, Kevin, is 5 years older than me. And then 2.5 years later was Elliot. And then 2.5 years was me. And then from me to our younger sister, Danielle, was 5 years. So Philip, being 2.5 younger than me, he fit like right into the birth order. So he's basically the unspoken fourth brother in the family. And since he only had one older sister at work, because he's like, I need some family, that's cool. And so we basically grew up together, feeling like family. And so it's weird to consider him like a friend, because it wasn't like, oh, we went to high school together. It was like no, he's like part of the family. And so he went to like camping trips and a church camp, and we used to ride our bikes around town, and he'd like trip all over the place and hurt himself. And we'd be like, I'm sorry, Vivian, I thought you taught him how to ride a bike. I didn't know he hadn't learned that yet. And so we started taking Philip out to church, and he ended up getting baptized when he was about 10. And so we bought him his first Bible, like in the church bookstore. And then I remember we wrote like to Philip from Travis, like 2006 in it, in my mom's handwriting because I was too embarrassed of my own. And you still use that Bible today, don't you? Yeah, so he still uses the Bible I gave him in 2006, which I've always thought was really cool. Yeah, it's totally falling apart. But you've always felt like genuinely like the third brother, like you were always right there. I think it helped that you were a little tall and I was a little short, so it like worked. We like were best friends even though you were younger than me, which I don't think it occurred to me till I was older why you were so clumsy, because I always felt like you were my age. I was like, why is he always falling down? I don't understand. But it's been really good to see you grow in your faith. And I don't think I'm ever going to forget when I came home from school and you were standing in the dining room because your parents' house was on fire. And we like basically babysat you. How old were you? Like 9?
10. Yeah.
You're 10. And like the main memory from that, because I don't remember much of it, I just remember he had like just been baptized and just got his Bible, and his house was like burnt from the kitchen up through the ceiling, and like everything was toast, except like the flame that went around his bedroom door. And I remember Philip at like 10 years old telling me that he thought God had saved his bedroom because the whole rest of the house was like completely destroyed. And that Bible that he still carries was in that house fire. And had like a little bit of smoke damage, but other than that was totally fine. And I remember that being for me was like it actually meant something to him, like his relationship with Christ, even at 10 years old, that it wasn't just like, oh, I tag along to church with you for fun. Yeah, I knew this speech would go on forever. I could talk about our childhood for like another 20 years. One thing I will say about your character, part of the reason we became friends, I've always appreciated it, is when we were kids, we had like all the cool stuff in my house because we had older brothers and like the GameCube and whatnot. And when friends would come over, we could get them to leave if they like found out we had to do chores or something. And so Philip and I had a signal for like, oh no, I have to mow the lawn, you guys have to leave. And it'd be like, Philip, don't go. We're good, like, we're just scaring the neighbor kids away. You can hang out, it's okay. And like, you would actually stick around sometimes and like mow the lawn and chop firewood and whatnot, which was always cool because I didn't want to do that kind of stuff. which is why he would always hurt himself. It's because he was chopping the wood and I wasn't. Anyways, I'll pass off the mic, but I will say I'm super stoked for you. And I know you've really grown just to be a man, and you work super hard, and you make really good decisions, better than me most of the time. And my family's known the Tarandos for eternity. And so I know their family, and I know they're great, and I'm really stoked for you to be married. And it's a huge blessing, and you guys are going to be great together. I love you guys.
Okay, cheers to Maddie and Philip Todak. Okay, Katie Baugh, are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you hear me all right? I was told I have to keep this close, so okay, I'll stand next. Okay, so like he just said, my name is Katie. I'm Maddie's cousin. Ew, I kind of hate that I can hear myself right now. Okay, fine. So how I want to frame this whole thing, because I don't want to ramble on, because we all know I can do that. Okay, so I want to say my first memory with Maddie, and then my first memory with Philip, and then both of them together. Are we tracking? Okay. So my... Oh, okay. So Maddie grew up in New York, and I grew up here, so obviously we weren't like super close till you guys moved here, like you were 10? Okay. So my first memory with Maddie was when their family came to our house for Christmas, and I got, all I wanted was a digital camera, and so I got this pink digital camera, and Maddie's like, I don't remember who like told this or whatever, so we're like, let's go to my room and let's take some photos. So we run back to my room, and Maddie was like the little girl that just wanted you to like watch her dance and tap dance and like just shake it. And so I loved that. And so I just took my camera and I would just videotape her singing the songs in my room and just like was so serious about it. And I just remember being like, this girl is like legit, because I just am goofy and whatever. And she just took it so seriously that it was like the best thing. And I just remember like, I don't know, I just really admired that about you. You just owned it and worked your thing. So she's the best. So then, Philip, you, yeah. So what's my, Zav kind of told how they first met, like the whole first date thing, and they went to Case Coffee and all that. But from my side of the story with Maddie, so she comes up to me before the service, and she's like, Katie, like, Philip messaged me on Facebook, and I'm like, Philip, like, okay, yeah, Philip. So he wants to go to lunch, but like, Katie, I cannot eat with him. Like, there's no way, I'll throw up. And I'm like, okay, yeah. I'm just kind of like, hey, what do I do? Okay. So just tell him I'm way too nervous to eat food, and like it'll break the ice, and he's probably nervous too, so it's fine. And I kind of know, like going into it, I knew that she probably wouldn't say that because she was nervous. She thought this guy was cute. But I was like, no, just break the ice. Like, she's like, Katie, you would do that. I can't do that. Like, there's no way I can tell him I'm nervous too. I'm like, no, it's fine. It'll like, it's fine. But So they went to Kate's Coffee, me knowing that they went to Kate's because I was the one suggesting that. We got the whole gang and went to Kate's Coffee too, naturally. So they sat in the very middle of Kate's. We walk in, I'm like, yes, they're still here. Because, you know, there's two cases, so you don't really know which one it is. So we go to the lower case, and they're just sitting there. Maddie's cup is, you know, big, not like this, but, and to the brim. She didn't even hardly take a drink the whole entire time. I'm like, Maddie, he went to the bathroom at one point. I'm like, Maddie, take a drink. Like, and they're just, she's like, Kate, we've been talking the whole time. Like, stop. Like, it's fine. I'm like, okay, sorry, so sorry. So I go and sit at the table, like, right. It's like from me to Bethann. Like, we were close. So it was incredible. Okay, so when I first knew Philip was, like, a keeper was this last Christmas. And we have a lot of personality on the Baugh, Trando, Maloney side. So I was like, okay, this is, like, a good test. Like, is can he handle us? So we all come here for Christmas Eve. And there's all of us. Like, it was a big group. And Philip, he just took it like a champ. You talk to everyone, because you never really know how it's going to go. And you just, we just loved you from the get-go. We knew you were meant to be with Maddie and in our family. You just, I mean, you saw Maddie's true colors when we were doing a gift exchange, and she was just like, no, no, no. I think, like, Ellie or someone, like, took her gift, and she was just like, I mean, it was like, oh, sweet girlfriend, but then it was like the real Maddie, like, give me that gift back, like, and I was like, ooh, Philip, like, you see her, like, she's crazy. No, so yeah, he did a great job at Christmas, and we're just so thankful to have you in the family, Cuzzo. I can officially call you Cuzzo. I've been calling him that for like 4 months, and he's like, Katie, we're not cousins yet. I'm like, okay, sorry, so sorry. So you called me Cuzzo yesterday, and I appreciate that, and so I love you both so, so much. And that's all I gotta say. So raise your glass or your parfaits if you don't like sparkling cider like me. Cheers. Love you guys.
All right. All right. Next up, Kevin Yonser, the oldest Yonser.
Okay, I'll try to keep this short and sweet as much as possible. So I'm Kevin Yonser, oldest in the Yonser clan, and he kind of tests on a lot of things, but I'll stand up for you, Philip. You may have been clumsy sometimes, but if you think about it, I was the oldest, and there's 8 years to you, I think, right? And that's like a huge gap, and we would just take them everywhere. Like, hey, we're going to do this crazy thing. We're going to do that crazy thing. Hey, we're going to go over here and buck firewood and use a chainsaw, and he would just tag along, do everything we did. I'm also thankful for his parents that they didn't like, hey, don't go hang out those crazy Yonsers, because every time he'd come back and he'd be like either full of poison oak everywhere and like, sorry, or he'd like have a gash from his leg because we all went on a crazy rock hopping adventure. But man, he would just always tag along. I love that about him. And then going into high school, I was coaching at Phoenix High School for track, and I got to coach him as an athlete for track. And he's one of those guys who just will do anything. You know, as a coach, you're always looking for somebody you can find and give responsibility to, and because you can't be everywhere. And man, he was one of those guys where I didn't have to worry about anything. He's like, hey, Philip, this has to be done or that has to be done. And I didn't have to think about, oh, is he going to screw off or is he going to do something wrong or not pay attention? Man, he's diligent. He stays on top of it, and it's just awesome. And, you know, being 8 years older, I've got to see him kind of blossom into an adult. And just Christian walk and being in at the story and just being involved with the prayer team and the doors and just seeing all this. And it's just so awesome to see him become a man and become responsible. We have conversations about, you know, money or finances or whatever. And like the things he thinks about, I'm like, I haven't really been thinking about that. And he's like planning things out and saving money. And he's just like got a great character. He's an awesome guy. And I'm so glad he found a great wife. The Tarantos, we've known for a while. Great family, and to see him plug in with someone like them, and just to have a bigger family now, it's been really cool, and I'm really happy for you guys. So cheers to these two.
Okay, so I like how the Yonsers are inserting themselves into our family, even though they're not actually related to Philip and Maddie. Well, you're not going to be with us on Christmas. There's already too many of us. But yeah, I think I'm going to speak just real quick with the guy with the mic on behalf of the Tarando boys. I don't speak for Ellie, but I do speak for us. look to the girls next to you, Maddie, and Philip, look to the guys next to you, and well done. You've picked a great squad to support you both. And that, who you choose to be the closest to you in your wedding day, is a testament to your character, because you guys have chosen men of character and women of character to lift you up and to hold you up in life. And that is a testament to your character, being both wonderful, beautiful people, made in the image of God, raised in good families, and now are coming together to join those families in a beautiful way. And these people are going to be with you for the rest of your life. We're not going to let you guys fail. We're going to be there for you. Maddie, your brothers love you, and we're going to be there for you. And you can always come to us for anything. And Philip, now you have Taylor, Noah, and myself to go to for anything. We're going to be there for you. We're going to love you guys, and we do love you guys. And I can't wait to have another crazy Christmas with the Bob Maloney Tarando clan. And I guess the answer is no. So, crap. Jason's good, I guess, but, you know, he's a nice guy. No, but I just wanted to say that we do love you guys, and you guys are wonderful. You guys are going to have a beautiful, wonderful, long marriage. And Philip, you're a great guy, and I care a lot about you. And you've shown me that you're going to take care of Maddie. You've shown my parents and everyone around you that you're going to really lead and love Maddie in the way that she needs to be leaded and loved. And so we just appreciate you so much. And Maddie, we love you. Be good to Philip. Don't drive him crazy. he drives you crazy too, but yeah, we love everything you guys are and everything you guys are going to be. Can't wait to see where you guys go. You guys are young and you have a lot of life ahead of you, so we're really excited to see that. Everybody raise your glass to Philip and Maddie one last time, and then we'll get on to... Oh, sorry, Danny. Yeah, last Danny. Here we go. Sorry.
Okay, so I wanted to say, if you could lift me up in prayers tomorrow. I'm going to be picking them up at 3:30 in the morning tomorrow to take them to the airport to go to Hawaii. So if you just think about me in our conversation in that car, it'll be fun. And then also I want to say thank you for letting me third wheel for the last 10 months. I just wanted to say thank you. Sorry. I'm done. There you go, Dan.
Okay, finally my moment. I very much like being the center of attention, so that was brutal for me to wait that out. Okay, hello. My name is Danny Yonser. I'm one of the many of us in the bridal party. I just wanted to remind you all of that little story Zav told in the ceremony about the annoying little girl. That's me. I am that girl. I'm Phillips. Not blood, but practically little sister. And I think by what Travis said, I met Philip when I was like 2. And then I met Maddie in, I think, 4th grade or something. And as I was thinking today, I would bet money that Maddie and I had a sleepover with our friends, and Philip definitely like passed through. Like for the ones at my parents' house that we had a sleepover, I bet Philip was there. So I just thought, how ironic. Anyways, I did not prepare for this speech, but I kind of wanted to give a little bit of a rundown of what happened behind the scenes with Maddie and Philip, because I was Maddie's roommate for a year. Like roommate. We shared everything, all of our living space. And I remember she came home from church one day and was like, "Danny, who's that cute guy that was sitting with your family? Like, he's not your actual brother, right?" And I was like, "Oh no, that's Philip. Like, you know, why are you asking?" And she was like, "I just think he's so cute," and whatever. And so I kind of blew it off because I was like, "Okay, Maddie, whatever. Like, whatever." And then, let's see, I think it was that week she came home from a concert and was like, told me this story about how she was sitting there and she saw this cute guy wearing a hat and she couldn't see his face. And then he turned around and it was Philip. And she was like, "Oh my gosh." And so she came home and told me this and she was like, "I really like him. I mean, he wears cute hats. I think he's like..." And she tells me, she goes, "I've always wanted my husband to wear cute hats." And I was like, "Oh boy, Maddie." So fast forward, I was at dinner one night with my parents, and I was telling them that story and how funny it is living with Maddie. And my mom was like, well, then make it happen. Like, set Maddie and Philip up, because he's totally oblivious. And I was like, that's the best idea you have ever had. And I immediately texted Philip and was like, you need to date my roommate. And he goes, which one? And I was like, the cute redhead. And yeah, then we made them sit together, as you heard. And that was really awkward for Maddie and Philip. And then and then they went on dates and whatever. And after Maddie's first date, I saw her at church, whatever, and you know, the whole thing with her family happened, and I hadn't heard any of that. I just went home to await like her coming back to me and telling me what happened. 10 hours later, practically, she shows up at home like dead tired and walks in, sits down on the couch and starts like crying and is like smiling and crying and like can't even talk. And I was like, what? Like, do you hate him? Like, he's not that bad. Like, I know this guy. And she goes, Danny, he's the one. Like, I'm not even kidding. She said that. And I literally, in that moment, was praying, like, Lord, guard Maddie's heart. Like, I was like, please, I pray that he is the one, because I don't want to see her so in love and be heartbroken. And man, they clicked instantly. And the moment I saw them together later that week, I was like, oh, yep, they're getting married. So I just wanted to say, all jokes aside, that Katie and I know Maddie and Philip probably best out of a few people here. And we both agree that Maddie, you handle Philip better than anyone. And Philip, you handle Maddie better than anyone. And I just love you guys. And you're really meant for each other. And yeah, I'm so blessed to know you so well and be a part of your lives. And I love you. Cheers.